Of North Idaho College and this evening's broadcast of the North Idaho College Public Forum. The crew is comprised of North Idaho College television students. Your moderator is North Idaho College political scientist, Tony Stewart.
This evening and again next week, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to be discussing with you a very serious topic, and that is the John F. Kennedy and the Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. assassinations. In order to deal with this very important issue of the United States, it is our pleasure to welcome to our program a man who was most involved in the investigation. Our guest is Kenneth Edward Bruton Jr. He is the former special counsel to the Select Committee on the Kennedy King Assassinations of the United States House of Representatives. And for a period of time, he served as the chief counsel and director of that select committee. He resigned that position in March 1977. He is presently in the practice of law with headquarters in Gainesville, Florida, and an office in Washington, D.C. As to educational background, he holds a doctorate of jurisprudence, or a law degree with honors from the University of Florida, a master's and bachelor's degree both from that same institution. He has attended Trinity College at the University of Cambridge in Cambridge, England. He also attended the Institute of Legal Services, the Polish Academy of Sciences in Warsaw, Poland. He is a native of Coeur d'Alene, Idaho, and has been very good to come back to his hometown to visit with us and to discuss this important matter with you. He has also served as a staff aide, a special assistant, and a legislative assistant to a number of United States congressmen. In 1977, he was selected among those people in Outstanding Young Men of America. Mr. Bruton, welcome to our program.
Thank you, Tony.
Joining with me in questioning our distinguished guests are two regular panelists, Mary Lou Reed and Janelle Burke. We'll proceed to questions at once in the first series from Mary Lou Reed.
Well, Ken, the investigations of President Kennedy and Martin Luther King were reopened after many intervening years. And why do you think this reopening was necessary? Why could sleeping dogs just not be left alone?
Well, we deal not simply with the assassination of John Kennedy and when it took place, but an assault upon the greatest, most powerful institution of our democratic society, the American presidency. And from the time of the assassination in November of 1963 until it was reopened again, we went through a period of Watergate. And during that time, the American public had a chance to find out that perhaps our government had not been as honest with us as we had all long thought they had been. Additionally, the Senate Select Committee to Study Governmental Operations was formed, and Senator Frank Church of Idaho chaired that committee. Among other things, they found that information had been withheld from the Warren Commission, and specifically information about assassination plots against Fidel Castro, Operation Amlash, and Operation Mongoose. They found, for example, that the Central Intelligence Agency had contracted with the Mafia to do in Fidel Castro, and all of that information had been withheld. Another committee of the House of Representatives found out that the FBI had destroyed material evidence in the Kennedy assassination, specifically the letter from Lee Harvey Oswald prior to the assassination to Agent Hostie of the FBI office in Dallas. And so, within that context, people began to question anew the findings of the Warren Commission that Lee Harvey Oswald, acting alone and unaided, was the sole assassin of President Kennedy.
Well, would you talk a little bit about the methodology of the Warren Commission and some of these other steps where the governmental intervention did not work out? What about the Warren Commission?
The Warren Commission was born out of the fire of a political compromise. History will record that there were numerous bills introduced in both the House and the Senate in 1963 to establish congressional committees to investigate the assassination of John Kennedy. Those committees were never formed, but instead, a, quote, blue ribbon presidential commission was formed. And that commission was comprised of some of the most well-known people in the United States, from the Chief Justice of the United States to Senator Russell of Georgia, subsequently President Ford, who was the House Minority Leader at the time, was on the Warren Commission, and a number of very well-known political figures. But in so doing that, The one point that we must always remember is we did not go to the basic institution in our democratic society that is the people's investigative body, and that is the grand jury. In retrospect, now we can look back and we can see what the federal grand jury did in another case involving the American presidency, and that was the case of Watergate. And in that case, the grand jury for the District of Columbia indicted a number of high government officials, including former Attorney General of the United States, John Mitchell.
Do you think information was purposely kept from the Warren Commission?
Yes, that was a conclusion reached by Senator Church's committee in their report, which was released on April the 23rd, 1976, prior to the formation of the House Select Committee on Assassinations. And in that report, they stated that the evidence adduced by the committee indicates that the investigation of the assassination was deficient, and that facts which might have substantially affected the course of the investigation were not provided the Warren Commission or those individuals within the Federal Bureau of Investigation and the Central Intelligence Agency who were charged with investigating the assassination. Because the Warren Commission, you see, relied to a very great extent, totally, almost, upon the intelligence agencies of the government to provide them with information. And here, nearly a decade and a half later, we find that information was intentionally withheld and evidence was intentionally destroyed.
Thank you.
Janelle Berg.
What, in your estimation, are the steps to an objective investigation? I think you've mentioned one, and that is not to bypass the grand jury. But what are other steps in an objective investigation? And how do you remain free of political pressure or special interest groups that are trying to pressure the individuals who are involved in the investigation into specific kinds of action?
Well, you've asked two questions, and let me respond
That's
to the
right.
last one first. How do you remain free from political influence? You set for yourself, or whoever does it, the conditions under which you will accept an appointment as counsel and the conditions under which you will leave. And I think it is imperative that a thorough investigation be done. I have often said that the greatest apolitical investigative body is a grand jury. And I believe that politics, however well-intentioned at times, taints with the possibility of exposure that individual members of Congress may have the outcome of an investigation. For me, as I said when I left, if the price of political compromise is a sacrifice of fundamental principles of a good and thorough investigation, then for me that price is too high and I won't pay it. And I left. As to your first question, with respect to the methodology that can be used for an investigation, I think it is imperative to be able to independently analyze information that is provided by agencies. That is not at all to say that the intelligence agencies of our government are incapable or unable of providing that information. But there has to be a way to independently cross-check that information to determine the validity of it. And as with a number of other things, methodology becomes exceptionally important to the outcome, because once you lack the credibility and once you lack the process, you also lack the validity of the conclusion.
Ms. Bruton, another area we would like to get into concerning the Select Committee of the House that investigated both Kennedy and King. Correct me if I'm wrong, but I believe the committee was organized in the fall of 1976 and has recently concluded at least its hearings, and I believe the report will be out shortly of those conclusions. But during this period of time from 1976 to the present time, the committee's gone through three chairmen, Mr. Downing from Virginia, and then Gonzalez of Texas, and last was Lewis Stokes of Ohio. And we hear a lot in the press about Richard Sprague, who served as counsel part of the time and you the other time, and the problem with Attorney Sprague and Mr. Gonzalez. Could you shed some light for our viewers on the fact that the investigation, among the other reasons you've given, was hindered by those facts, was also hindered by the fact that it seems that the committee could not organize? What is really the story behind
this tremendous problem of carrying on the investigation by this congressional committee?
First, I think you have to look at the time and the context when the committee was formed. It was formed in the last days of the Congress in an election year. It was formed under pressure from the Black Caucus leaders to reinvestigate the assassination of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., which arose in part out of the report of the Pike Committee in the House about the counterintelligence program that had been carried on against Dr. King by the Federal Bureau of Investigation. The appointment of Chairman Downing, who was a lame duck member of Congress, I think hindered to a great degree the initial direction that the committee had to take. The differences between Mr. Gonzalez and Mr. Sprague were not differences of personality, as was, I think, reported. I think that might have been the more visible tip of the iceberg because of the confrontations between the two men. But this was a legislative investigation, and Mr. Gonzalez wanted to go back to review and carefully analyze what had been done by the intelligence agencies of the government, and then find those areas which required further investigation and further exploration, and proceed from that point. Mr. Sprague, on the other hand, is an experienced prosecutor, and he wanted to run it somewhat like a very large type of an investigation, and start from the beginning and reevaluate the entire case. He said, for example, that unless the committee received an appropriation of $6.5 million in their first year of operation, that they would not be able to effectively carry out a thorough and comprehensive investigation. Then, when the committee received $2.5 million, it seems to have lacked all of the credibility that was necessary. Mr. Gonzalez wanted to move in a rather slow, methodological, analytical type of manner. I think history will record that some of the members of the committee, many of them who were first and second year members of Congress, were men of shallow vision who placed their own personal political ambitions ahead of the search for the truth about either assassination. And I say that because they dribbled out little bits and pieces of information. And as the days of the first Congress closed, the committee was coming to an end and had to be reconstituted. And all of these dangling little tidbits of information of this may lead to this and this may lead to this completely, in my judgment, destroyed the credibility of the committee from that point. And so the differences weren't differences simply of personality. It was a difference of very fundamental philosophy on how a legislative investigation should be run.
Thank you. Lou Reed.
Do you think there is a place for a legislative investigation?
Yes, I do. And I think that the legislative activities of Senator Church's committee, the Senate Select Committee to Study Governmental Operations, brought out the validity of that. There were no spectacular headlines. There were no on-camera television types of things. They issued their report, and the report was comprehensive. It was based on evidence, and it was a report that was done in a quiet, dispassionate manner. And so I think that there are. As a result of that, the Senate Permanent Intelligence Committee was formed, which now has oversight jurisdiction over the activities of U.S. intelligence agencies. And I think it matters a great deal of which legislative body conducts it. The members of the House are, of course, up for election every 2 years. The members of the Senate are up for election once every 6 years. And I think there's probably a little more maturity in the members of the Senate than there are in the members of the House.
Do you think we should expect legislation as a byproduct of these different legislative committees? Is this something, or is oversight sufficient?
Well, I think that the two are natural concomitants. The oversight should show the deficiencies, if any, in the existing legislation. And then if new legislation is required, for example, the rewriting of the Charter of the Central Intelligence Agency, then that becomes a function of that oversight committee.
Janelle Burt.
Is it really important to know what happened then, and why is it important to know what happened then?
I think at this point it is important to know that neither the Warren Commission nor the House Select Committee on Assassinations was able to carry out a credible investigation into the assassination of John Kennedy. I think if we do not learn from the past, as Santayana wrote, we will be condemned to repeat it.
Even now, why is there so much cover-up?
Well, I don't know. Your question presupposes that there is cover-up, and I have not concluded that there is. Perhaps it is a matter of insufficient investigation. And cover-up gives the idea that there's some kind of conspiracy to withhold information from the public. The failure to properly investigate has the same effect. But if people know of the existence, government officials know of the existence of information, and they do not reveal it, then I think that in a democratic society, the greatest infidelity of a government to its people is the intentional and willful suppression of the truth. We can't tolerate it, and we shouldn't have to.
At this point, Mr. Bruton, I think we have covered rather extensively, or you have, and in a most articulate way, some of the problems of mythology and the forming of committees for investigative purposes. I would like for us now to take a look at some of the evidence that you have seen as an investigator and concerning these particular assassinations. Let's take the John Kennedy assassination first. The Warren Commission's final report indicated that Lee Harvey Oswald was a lone assassin and did this without any assistance. And yet, as time has passed, as you've indicated, the American people have not been satisfied with that conclusion. I'm impressed with some of your comments in the past concerning the problems that the Warren Commission and even the House Select Assassination Committee have had concerning the two types of evidence. That one approached it so much from certain theories and come to conclusions, and you have indicated more specific physical evidence that should have been pursued. This is a rather involved question, and I would like for you to take all the time you need for the answer, but what are the holes or the loopholes in the Warren Commission's report about Kennedy? What are those unanswered questions, or what facts do you have that would bother the American people that should have been followed by this study or investigation or by a grand jury?
Well, first, let's look at what happened in Dallas immediately after the assassination of President Kennedy. There was literal chaos. There was conflicts between local, state, and federal agents and agencies, and there were confrontations between them. As a result of that, over a three-day period of time, the alleged assassin of President Kennedy, Lee Harvey Oswald, was interrogated by local, state, and federal agents for a total of approximately 12 hours. This is from Friday, November the 22nd, 1963, until Oswald was shot at about 11:51 a.m., I believe, on Sunday, November the 24th. Yet according to the sworn testimony of Captain Fritz of the Dallas Police Department, there were no stenographic or tape recordings made of those interrogation sessions. And I think it defies both reason and logic and even the fundamental principles of the simplest type of an investigation. That whereas here, the interrogation was being made of an individual who is alleged to have assassinated the President of the United States, not a single thing was tape recorded or taken down stenographically. We don't know why, and it leaves it to us to speculate.
May I interject here to make the point? The Warren Commission did not pursue this and demand testimony from all of those investigators that had questioned Mr. Oswald. Is that correct?
Yes, sir. That's my understanding.
Do you suppose that a federal grand jury would have demanded testimony from those individuals?
Well, you know, I have often said that were I to place my faith in 24 politicians or 24 of the citizens of this nation who were not seeking political office, I would take the latter.
But many of those people that were with the FBI, the CIA, or the Dallas police, or whomever might have been questioning Mr. Lee Harvey Oswald, most of those people are still alive, and could this not this particular line of investigation be continued at this time by the proper investigative machinery?
It could, in the event the matter was reopened. And one of the things that the Select Committee on Assassinations did is they referred the matter to the Justice Department, having spent nearly $6 million. They said, we feel this matter needs further investigation, and the people at the Justice Department are not entirely happy about that. The second area, which concerns me quite seriously, is the matter of the performance of the postmortem examination on John Kennedy at the National Naval Medical Center in Bethesda, Maryland. Now, we know that during the course of that postmortem examination, which was performed not by forensic pathologists who were used to dealing with traumatic death, but with professorial type of pathologists who taught there and who did not perform postmortem examinations on a regular basis. Some of the things that occurred were that we know that on at least three occasions during the course of that postmortem examination, the enlisted men were ordered out of the autopsy suite. One of those occasions was when a hematoma or a blood clot was found under the scapula in the intercostal muscles of the right side on the remains of President Kennedy. Now, the single bullet theory of the Warren Commission is predicated upon Lee Harvey Oswald's having fired three shots from a 6.55 Mannlicher Calcano rifle. One of the shots missed. One of the shots, according to the commission, went through the back of President Kennedy's neck, exited his throat about midline in the trachea, went through the back of Governor Connally through three ribs, came out his chest, went through his wrist, went through a fleshy part of his leg, and was later found on a stretcher at Parkland Hospital. That is Warren Commission Exhibit 399. It came out relatively unscathed. It is the only tangible piece of evidence that links that 6.55 rifle to Lee Harvey Oswald that was found on the sixth floor of the Texas School Book Depository. The second shot, the Warren Commission said, struck the president from behind and blew away a great portion of his cranium. So we are asked to believe that a World War II low-velocity type of weapon could go all the way through someone's body and come out unscathed, and yet hit someone in the head, that same person, and completely explode and have an explosive type of a force. Now, if a piece of that bullet, that Commission Exhibit 399, had struck any particle of bone or anything else, it would have fragmented. If the hematoma were caused by a fragmentation of a bullet, then it couldn't have been Commission Exhibit 399. Conversely, if it were caused by a piece of bone fragment in that area, it would have had an impact upon the bullet and it would not have come out in that state. And this is a type of physical evidence instead of relying on acoustical evidence as they did. And they hedged on their conclusion. The whole problem with these investigations is there have been too many conclusions and too few facts.
One of the problems, and I'll return to the panel, and that is if Lee Harvey Oswald had not been himself assassinated, that many of these things would have surely come out in his trial. Do you think that the Dallas police were very poor in their techniques of removing him and announcing to the media they were removing him? Should he not have been protected more so that he would have survived for a trial and given us another chance to have seen some more of the facts?
Well, I think that they made a media spectacular out of it. And there was absolutely no reason for it. If you will recall, when James Earl Ray was brought back, they had him in a bulletproof gown. And perhaps some police departments learned something for that. There was absolutely no reason to parade Lee Harvey Oswald before the press, in my judgment. I think it was a tremendous error in judgment.
Lou Reed.
Well, did any further evidence come out about Jack Ruby, the nightclub owner, that would connect him, perhaps?
Well,
is there evidence there that we are not aware of?
There was evidence which was adduced not simply by the Select Committee on Assassinations, but prior to that by an author by the name of Seth Cantor, who is a newsman, who wrote a book about Jack Ruby. And in that book, he points out the relationship between Jack Ruby and certain figures of organized crime. The Select Committee brought out that same type of information, but it was previously established independently by an author. So there was a connection, I think, quite fair to say. between Jack Ruby and some elements of organized crime. We do know, for example, that Mr. Giancana and Mr. Roselli are both dead, having been invited to testify as to their knowledge of the hit that was supposed to have been placed on Fidel Castro at the contract insistence of the Central Intelligence Agency. So there are many facets of that which perhaps required exploration.
If we did have a conspiracy, who are the likeliest conspirators? Who are the names that are mentioned the most often?
Well, I really don't want to speculate about that, because that's exactly what it is. I don't think all of the data are in. I don't think all of the evidence is in. I do know that in the final report that the committee has issued, though they have not issued their evidentiary report to back it up yet, that they have said that the two areas that require looking into are certain members of organized crime and certain members of anti-Castro Cuban forces. They went at great lengths to clear the agencies of government, to clear the government of Cuba, to clear the government of the Soviet Union, and so on. But the problem with this whole thing, as I see it, is that too many people have been speculating too long with too little evidence.
Janelle Burke.
How are the assassinations connected, or is there any evidence that they were, or related?
I don't know, and again, that would require some speculation of whether or not they were connected. I don't know of any, personally, I do not know of any credible evidence to connect the two assassinations. There are, of course, a number of theorists, and for every theorist, there is at least one book written about the theory from everybody from the Umbrella Man on down. The character of Raoul has cropped up in both of them, but there, I don't think, has been any credible evidence. That's not to say that it doesn't exist. That's only to say that I don't know of any.
There were some similarities, however, perhaps in the way the case was handled by the intelligence agencies.
Yes, there were. And again, Dr. King was under constant surveillance by the FBI. And the FBI entered the case, I think, at 2 minutes after six, some 5 minutes after the shooting, on the basis of a violation of civil rights.
I must interrupt there. It's a good point to break. We will continue that next week. Ladies and gentlemen, our guest has been Kenneth Edward Bruton, Jr., who served as a chief counsel to the Select Committee on Assassinations in the House. Next week, we wish to continue to discuss both the Kennedy and King assassinations with more evidence that he will look at. I hope you'll join us at that time. I am Tony Stewart. Have a good week.
North Idaho College Public Forum can be seen at this same time each week over this station. This production was videotaped earlier by a North Idaho College student crew for viewing at this more appropriate time. Of North Idaho College and this evening's broadcast of the North Idaho College Public Forum. The crew is comprised of North Idaho College television students. Your moderator is North Idaho College political scientist, Tony Stewart.
This evening, we will continue our discussion from last week on the serious topic, the assassinations of John F. Kennedy and Martin Luther King, Jr. We wish to welcome back to our program Kenneth Edward Bruton, Jr. for that discussion. He is the former special counsel to the Select Committee on the Kennedy-King assassinations in the United States House of Representatives. And for a period of time, he served as the chief counsel and director of that Select Committee. After some disagreement, Mr. Bruton resigned that position in March 1977. He is an attorney practicing law with his headquarters in Gainesville, Florida, and a law office in Washington, D.C. As to educational background, Mr. Bruton holds a Doctor of Jurisprudence or a law degree with honors from the University of Florida in Gainesville.
He also holds a master's degree and baccalaureate degree in journalism from that same institution. He has traveled extensively and attended other institutions, including Trinity College at the University of Cambridge in Cambridge, England. He has also attended the Institute of Legal Services, the Polish Academy of Sciences in Warsaw, Poland. He is a native of Coeur d'Alene and was educated in the primary and secondary schools of that city. He has also been involved with congressional administrative work as a staff aide, a special assistant, and legislative assistant to several congressmen. He has also received the Outstanding Young Men of America Award in the year 1977. Mr. Bruton, we have many questions. We'd like to continue from last week's discussion. Welcome back.
Thank you.
Joining with me again in questioning our guests are two regular panelists, Mary Lou Reed and Janelle Burke, and we will invite Lou Reed to commence the questioning.
Ken, will you tell us a little bit about the sad story of Billy Lovelady, who is the Oswald look-alike, and we understand that he was hounded by reporters and people who wanted his autograph. He could not find any privacy at all, and you have played some part in attempting to get his material back from the investigators for him. Will you tell us a little bit about Billy?
Well, I first met Billy Nolan Lovelady when I went out to interview him in the West, and he was a quiet man. Unfortunately, Billy Nolan Lovelady was thrust onto the stage of history at the very moment that John Kennedy was shot. The resemblances between Billy Lovelady and Lee Harvey Oswald were so striking that his wife of 3 years mistook Oswald for him at a distance of about 50 feet. When President Kennedy was shot, he had his hands up to his throat on the first shot. An Associated Press photographer by the name of Altkins took a photograph at that moment, and in the doorway of the Texas School Book Depository, there stood Billy Nolan Lovelady. There were all kinds of theories about that. People hounded him. They followed him. They sought his autograph. They called him. They accused him of being part of the assassination. You know, there are many very, what I call the assassinologists, who have very many weird theories. But Billy Lovelady was a quiet type of a man that never asked for that, and he never sought it out, yet he was thrust into that portion of history. And so he left Texas and he moved to Colorado. And on the 14th of January of this year, Billy Lovelady died at the age of 41 of a heart attack.
What materials did the investigators have that Billy wanted to get back?
They had some photographs, which were original photographs, taken around the time of his marriage, taken in 1963, so that they could do a comparative analysis between those photographs and the photographs, and the Altkins photograph.
And were you able to get them back for him?
Oh, yes, we got them back, and in matter of fact, I talked to Billy Lovelady on the Sunday before he passed away. Called him to make sure that he had gotten the things back, and we talked about going fishing. He was that type of a person.
He was just one of those unnecessary sacrifices along the way.
He was. He is a victim of this.
Janelle Burke.
From quite a different kind of world came James Earl Ray. Can you tell us what kind of a strange world he existed in, and what was different about his world before and after the assassination?
James Earl Ray was a small-time crook. I think you could suffice it to say that. That covers a multitude of sins, of criminal violations, but none of them were very big. He was a street crook. He was a hold-up artist. He escaped a year prior to the assassination from the Missouri State Penitentiary. He then traveled rather widely throughout the United States. He had plastic surgery done on his nose. He took dancing lessons. Took bartending lessons. He traveled back and forth across the width and the breadth of the nation. He was able to get passports, Canadian passports, on which he subsequently traveled, of the names, using the names and the addresses and the identities of four real individuals who lived in a certain area of Scarborough in Toronto, Canada. One of them had such a striking resemblance to him that he even had the scar in the same place as did James Earl Ray. Of course, after the assassination, He was able to elude an entire international police force, travel to England, go to Portugal, and finally was apprehended in Heathrow Airport in England. And one of the things that has always concerned me about that, about those facts, are where did he get the money? Those questions haven't been answered. And what the committee, the House Select Committee on Assassinations, concluded was that this required further investigation by the Department of Justice, especially into the relationship of his family, some of his brothers and so on. They also concluded that there was some evidence of a possible $50,000 reward being given. But what we're really asked to believe is that a person who has spent most of his life in prison as a petty street crook was able to pull off an assassination of this magnitude, was able to get all the necessary documents, was able to travel halfway around the world and all the way across the country, and not have help from someone.
Who does James Earl Ray say was his help?
He said it was a man by the name of Raoul. And the name Raoul comes up in both the Kennedy and the King assassinations. I believe the committee concluded that there was no credible evidence of the existence of a Raoul in either case. And to my personal knowledge, I know of no credible evidence of the existence of a Raoul. It is one of those theories that has been kicking around for some time.
How is it related to the Kennedy assassination?
Well, Raoul was supposedly one of the people of the Three Tramps that was in Dallas that day. They showed there are some photographs of the three people who were arrested but never booked. No one ever took their name. And they were subsequently released without knowing who they were, without taking their names, addresses, fingerprints, or anything.
What about James Earl Ray's brother? He has sometimes been mentioned in connection.
Yes, it may be coincidental, but 2 days before Ray escaped from prison, his brother visited him. We do know that James Earl Ray made some calls back to the United States. We do know that his brothers contacted attorneys in Birmingham, Alabama, for him. His brothers played a major role in his defense. We do know that when the plea was taken, his brothers were present, along with his attorney then, Percy Forman. And when the judge asked him whether or not he was guilty, he said, yes, legally guilty. And you must understand that legal guilt does not mean that he was admitting to the judge that he had been the one that fired the shot.
I think we should pursue this a little further. When you were with the Select Committee on Assassinations in the United States House of Representatives, the chairman of that committee at that time, Henry Gonzalez, I think emphasized rather strongly this problem with James Earl Ray being such a poor background and rather a failure, but yet having so much money in such a short period of time and traveling around the world. I believe he indicated, and you can paraphrase this much better than I, that on a trip that the congressman took, he indicated that anyone who believed that James Earl Ray alone could have done this without any assistance must also believe in Santa Claus and the Tooth Fairy and the Easter Bunny, I believe. Would you agree with this comment and conclusion by the congressman?
Well, it takes a great imagination for anyone to believe that someone could do all of these things without having help from someone and not working, because there was no evidence that James Earl Ray was working during this time. Yet he bought a car, he expended money, the white Mustang, and it's something that kind of defies the imagination. And I think what Mr. Gonzalez was saying is that you would have to have an imagination perhaps of a four-year-old who believed in the Good Fairy and the Tooth Fairy and the Easter Bunny and Santa Claus.
Both the Warren Commission's report and the Select Committee in the House, although it's not a final report to the public yet, in the latter case, have you seen any figures or estimations on approximately how much money that it would have taken James Earl Ray to carry on prior to the assassination as he did, and then the trips that he took afterwards? I know that there's no way of being totally specific, but what kind of estimation of how much money would have to have been involved?
Somewhere around $20,000 over that period of time from his escape until his apprehension in England.
Some of those who take the position that he was the lone killer of Dr. King and that there was no one else involved try to explain the fact that he received that money through some kind of crime or robberies just prior to the King assassination. Does that hold any validity?
Well, there was some attempt made early on to try to show that he had held up some different places. He did work at one job. I think he washed dishes for a couple weeks somewhere. But what you're asked to believe, if you can believe that, is that here's a person who literally bumbled everything that he did and got caught at it, pulled that off, and then pulled off this grand scam, and the type of thing that would require rather sophisticated investigation to find people that look like you and knowledge of how to go about getting a Canadian passport, using these different aliases, having your photograph taken, using different addresses, all within a certain area of Canada. And there was no evidence, I don't think, that he had ever been to Canada before. So it raises a number of very interesting questions. Unfortunately, as with a number of things, I have yet to see any evidence about how those questions were answered. And if they cannot be answered, then I think it should have been incumbent upon the committee to say that we simply could not find the evidence to answer this. That would have had a refreshing air of credibility.
This next question, I hope, is a fair one, and please ignore it if it is not. Do you think that the Select Committee of the U.S. House of Representatives did an adequate preparation and then execution of their questioning of James Earl Ray when they brought him to the Congress? Was it at all productive? Here's a man still alive that may have the key to this question, and yet, at least my observation was that it was not very productive when he appeared before the committee.
Well, you have to look also at who he appeared with. He appeared with Mark Lane. Mark Lane, as you know, wrote several books and lectured rather widely about the Kennedy assassination. Mark Lane is the same attorney then who assumed the representation of James Earl Ray and was writing and lecturing on that. Mark Lane was also the person who was in Jonestown with the mass suicides down there. As to the adequacy of the preparation, they brought up some issue about some constable over there, and Lane was able to simply torpedo him on it. And he apparently was correct. It was one of those media events. And the problem with conducting an investigation of this nature and magnitude is it should be conducted in a calm and in a quiet, methodological, analytical manner, not before television cameras when you're bringing people in to question them. And there was more bickering going on between the witness and his counsel and the committee and their counsel. And every member of the committee up there that was present for that session all got their 2 minutes worth of say in, and it gave them the exposure that they wanted. And this is the very type of thing that Mr. Gonzalez did not want. It's the very type of a thing that I think destroyed the credibility of that committee, the lack of preparation.
Lou Reed.
Well, do you feel that that committee really did in Congressman Gonzalez? Were they unfair to him in the dispute between Richard Sprague, the prosecutor, and the chairman? He came out in the minority of one, as it would appear.
There is a saying that one man plus the truth makes a majority. And whether he came out on top or on bottom of it, he came out with his own respectability because he went into it with the same way that I went into it. And when it turned political, he did not want to have a part of it. And Mr. Sprague was very adept at the manipulation of young members of Congress and providing them with information so that they could release it on their local hometown television shows. And it was a subject, the whole assassination matter was a very hot media topic in Washington. And literally, you could command headlines in a number of newspapers any day of the week by dribbling out little bits of information. Mr. Gonzalez wanted it stopped. And as I have said previously, I think that history will record that some of the members of the committee were people of shallow vision who placed their own personal political ambitions ahead of the search for the factual truth of both of these investigations.
Well, was there a lot of feather bedding on this committee? Were other congressmen dumping their extra staff on this committee? And was an unusually large staff of people not necessarily working that hard?
Yes.
Were all these allegations true?
Yes. And in fact, unknown to Chairman Gonzalez, Mr. Sprague had unilaterally hired 23 people before the expiration of the Congress, put them on the payroll, and then said, now we have to have the money to pay them. We have hired them. And he didn't even consult with the chairman on it. He did it unilaterally. Part of that grew out of the fact that former Chairman Downing was retiring. As I said, he was appointed because he was appointed by his friend, the Speaker, who was a lame duck speaker appointing a lame duck chairman who abdicated all of his responsibilities to Richard Sprague, who didn't confer with anyone, and he hired these people, and then he said, now we must pay him. And on that, Congressman Downing dumped a number of members of his staff. It's kind of the what we call down in Florida the good old buddy approach.
In your experience, does this happen a lot in Congress? Are these
I think
is there
it
a
does.
Lot of misuse of the subcommittees and the committee system?
Well, Congress has changed dramatically since I first went there in 1962. When I first went to the Congress in 62, there was a seniority system, there was an order, there was a predictability, there was an ability to get things done. As Congress grows and as these reforms have taken over, and by the reforms I mean the demise of the seniority system, then you have young first-term members of Congress who have the ability, united together, to do whatever they want to do. And they may do something not because it is in the best interest of the people or in the best interest of the best legislation, but because they want to gain some type of notoriety at home so that they can run for the next political office that they're going to run for.
You would suggest that reform is not necessarily always for the better.
Reform is not necessarily always for the better, nor does it mean that it is progress in the right direction.
Janelle Burke.
I have a series of three little questions, and the first one is following up sort of on what Lou has been asking. Do you have any tips on how we can read between the lines, between the political rhetoric? How can we sort of separate out in our own minds when we hear things on the news so that we do get a more clear picture of what really is going on?
Well, I think you have to first go back to the way and the methodology with which the Congressional Committee, be it a Senate committee or a House committee, approaches it. I use the Church Committee in the Senate because they did a tremendous service for the people of this nation in the way they handled the abuses of the intelligence agencies. They did it in a quiet manner. They issued their report in a quiet manner. There was no spectacularism about it. And that led to the formation of another permanent type of committee. I think that when you evaluate things, you have to evaluate them within that context, the credibility of it. Is it destroyed by political bickering? And I think that if you can understand that and understand the process about how it works, then it becomes much more credible than a media type of spectacular that was held forth with the House Select Committee on Assassinations. The Pike Committee did the same thing, the Intelligence Committee in the House. It was like a sieve. They had so many leaks coming out of it about the counterintelligence program that had been mounted by the Federal Bureau of Investigation against Martin Luther King Jr. And they weren't able to control the flow of information. And when that occurs, then people wonder whether it's a matter of simply releasing it and trickling out little dribbles and dabbles of information to keep people interested, or whether it's a leak. And if it's a leak, it ought to be stopped. We must have a certain amount of privacy in whatever we do, especially where national security is involved.
In an investigation which involved the loss of lives, did you ever feel that your life was personally endangered?
Well, I never really worry about that. I never worried about that. Life is too short to be worrying about what might happen if you know something. And I decided a long time ago I wasn't going to be doing that.
My last and final question really deals with the role of the women who were involved. Mrs. Oswald, Mrs. Kennedy, Mrs. King, did they have any influence at all on the investigations?
I think if you take a look at how the House Select Committee on Assassinations was formed, you will find that Mrs. King literally went with the Black Caucus delegation to the Speaker's office, Carl Albert, and said, "We want this thing opened." And I think she was a very powerful force in having the investigation reopened. As to Mrs. Kennedy, I don't think she really did anything one way or the other. But the Kennedy family, through Eunice Shriver, made it very clear that they did not want a reinvestigation into the assassination of John Kennedy. There have been allegations, and I say that they are allegations, about Marina Oswald, that she was threatened with deportation if she did not testify before the Warren Commission. But certainly she was thrust into some place in history which she didn't really ask for. All three of the women were. In that respect, they were somewhat like Billy Nolan Lovelady.
Mr. Bruton, something else that you have discussed with our students at the college that was very impressive, you have made some critical comments concerning some individuals and how they abuse the power in the FBI, the CIA, and other agencies. However, you have explained the importance of those organizations. Now that we've had some concerns in our country after these assassinations and Watergate, where do we stand with organizations such as that and their role in our society?
Well, I think that it must be patently clear that we're living in a very tough world these days, and I think it is imperative that we have a very, very, very strong intelligence gathering arm of our government, because that deals directly with the national security of every individual in this nation. And if we don't have that, then we're going to be very vulnerable. And I think one of the prime examples of that recently was the underestimation of what went on in Iran with Khomeini and the literal overthrow of the Shah. I think it demonstrates the necessity for this. I think that there have been demonstrated on a number of occasions abuses of power by the CIA, by the FBI, but we need both of these organizations. And what has happened, as I see it in the past, is Congress abdicated their role of oversight responsibility over the intelligence agencies of government. And now they are regaining that role, and they were regaining that oversight. But I think that because of the actions of some employees or agents of either of these two groups, the CIA and the FBI, that we mustn't condemn it, nor must we condemn the concept of it, because it is absolutely imperative that we do. We're in competition with the KGB. We're in competition with all of the foreign intelligence gathering units of the world. And this is a pretty tough world, as we've seen by recent events abroad. So I think that we must have it, but Congress must assume the role to permit the system of checks and balances to operate within our government. And they had not assumed that role previously.
So we can conclude from your comments that without the organizations at all, we'd be in danger, but also we'd be in equal danger if we did not keep them in proper check and define it by law.
That's right, and I think that the oversight activities of the Congress then can perhaps lead to legislation so that there will not be abuses, but you can't throw the baby out with the bathwater.
I would like to move back to something quite different in what time we have left, and if we have more time, I'll return to Lou. One point I think it'd be worth bringing out would be the fact that Jack Ruby's background in relation to the Kennedy question. I believe you had some comments earlier today about some possible connections that he had that might be worth consideration if one was involved in an investigation.
Does he have, or did he have, some organized crime connection?
Yes, he did. And Seth Cantor, who was a reporter for the Scripps Howard newspapers and is now, I believe, a reporter for the Atlanta Constitution and the head of their Washington Bureau, was in Texas for a number of years. He knew Jack Ruby. I mean, he knew who he was. And Seth Cantor has written a very fine book about the activities of and the relationships between Jack Ruby and organized crime and who Jack Ruby really was. And of course, the Select Committee on Assassinations brought out virtually the same information that prior to the assassination of Lee Harvey Oswald by Jack Ruby, which was nationally televised, he had made a number of calls to certain of James Hoffa's lieutenants. And so I think that there are some very, very clear areas there. Of course, we've also know that the CIA contracted with Giancana and Roselli and others in the mafia to do away with Castro, a fact that was never brought to the Warren Commission's attention.
With that, I'm afraid we're out of time. I wish we had time to pursue some of these matters more closely. But I want to express on behalf of our staff our very sincere appreciation for the two appearances. You have been most informative to our audience.
Thank you.
And I hope you'll come back. Ladies and gentlemen, our guest has been Kenneth Edward Bruton, Jr., who served as special counsel to the Select Committee on the Assassinations for the United States House of Representatives in the United States Congress, and for some time was the chief counsel and director of that Select Committee. As you know, he's been with us both this week and last week to discuss how those committees were set up and the Warren Commission and what he felt was an error concerning the methods used. And we have been discussing both some of the details of the Kennedy and King assassinations. I hope you've enjoyed our programs, and may I invite you to be with us again next week at the same time when again we'll discuss what we believe to be a most important issue in our country. Until that time, have a good week. I am Tony Stewart.
The North Idaho College Public Forum can be seen at this same time each week over this station. This production was videotaped earlier by a North Idaho College student crew for viewing at this more appropriate time.